Do you have a favorite particular rubber band that you like best?
I don't know enough to know. I got these, which are pretty good. I just ordered a bunch of them. These are. These are sterlings, and I like that they're red. You know, there's a lot of other colors, but the problem when you get into yellow or blues or other things is then they look like they're magic props.
Yep.
But a red rubber band is a normal sort of thing. I show this to a guy who does like a lot of rubber band magic. Like, oh, these are good. I'm like, I'm Amazon.
Are those the ones that are there's some that I don't know if they're used for hair bands or whatever, but they're not made of rubber. It's kind of like a polymer plastic type
It
stuff.
I think actually these are just
Oh, you broke it. Why you
yeah.
broke it, man?
Sorry about that. But that's cool as they come back. So
What? My favorite
these
gig.
are, I think these are just regular rubber bands. I thought they were like one of these Aller, you know, latex or you know, latex or something or other, but I think they're just regular rubber bands, but they're pretty good.
Right on. Well, I'll tell you what. Do you want to take the stream for a moment, and I will run downstairs and get a beverage and some ice in my bucket, and then we're ready to go.
All right, everybody, it's Andrew Main improving live for the streams, for the peoples. So what's new with you guys? I'm just holding down the stream. Can't be that hard. Brian and Justin do it. In all seriousness, if you haven't already got your copy of Name of the Devil pre-ordered, that's okay. We can still be friends. But if you haven't got your free copy of Andrew Main's Fire in the Sky, a Jessica Blackwood short story, which is free. It is free on Amazon and every place else. It's a nice little brisk read. I think you'll enjoy it. Check it out. You can download it now. Go get it. You don't read it during the show, but get it. Jessica goes on a little mini adventure, and we learn a little bit of insight into critical thinking, dogmatism, and how even really smart people like Jessica sometimes have to sit back and observe. So check it out. Totally free. Totally free. And as of course, on July 7th, that's when Name of the Devil comes out. Stoked about that one. Can't wait for you guys to see that book, you know, if you're into that kind of thing. Publishers Weekly just gave it a really nice review, which, you know, some people talk about the sophomore slump. They didn't think so. They thought it was a really good sequel. So that's all I got to say about that. In other news, I still haven't seen Ex Machina. Haven't seen that. Brian wanted me to watch Mr. Robot. Didn't see that. I did watch a lot of ESPN 30 for 30s while sitting around, not writing. I was going to get a lot of writing done this week. I got some writing done, but not as much as I should have because yeah, I just kind of got a little lazy. Had my birthday Monday and then went to Chuck E. Cheese. Didn't do much beyond that. Sat around a lot. I walked, but then, you know, basically that Mars experiment where they want to see how long, you know, what happens to people when they stay in bed for like a month or a year.
That's
I've been doing
right.
that on my
You're
own.
doing some independent research in that regard?
Totally, totally.
Sounds good. Totally legit. Justin?
Yeah, man.
Scam 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 Oh, yeah. Wait, was that an intentional move to have it do a spinning around
Yeah,
thing?
it was a 311 thing that I.
Oh, I love that. There was a time that I had that Chris Kenner come back to you thing worked out, but then I lost it and I've never got it back.
That is so knacky that I can't even. I don't even bother.
Yeah.
I hate
Dude,
myself
why am
enough.
I not 19 again? Where I can do that?
Well, all the guys I know who can do it are like over 50.
Yeah,
Chris Kenner, I know Paul Daniels does it, talks about like, oh, I did this thing, so.
I'll tell you what, man. There was I think I have to speak in code. So I was talking to some people about a project. I believe I called you on it. And after talking about it, we were looking for a thing and came across a website that's filled with, by searching for a certain illusion by name, we found a website that categorizes all the different illusions, says who made it, and it lists it as protected, licensed, or public domain. And by which they mean, you know, protected means there's an actual patent or a copyright on it. Licensed means you need to talk to the creator. It's generally considered that he's the one that would like to license out the rights to it, or public domain is everybody's making it. Do you know which resource I'm talking about?
I know of a website that does that, and I know it's not all right. I know that I've seen things in there. What's that?
I said, oh, really? Although it did say on there, hey, if we're wrong on anything, please contact us. I found it admirable that they were at least trying to categorize it.
Because it may be different. The one I saw was clearly a couple creators and some people put this thing out there to say, this is ours. I'm like, nope, this thing predates this. Nope, this predates this. And I'd love to see my probably different one. Love to see this one.
Yeah, I hesitate to look it up now on air just because of my tip what we were up to. But maybe off the air we can take it.
Yeah, curious. As long as you're not doing exposure, that's all I say.
Dude, when have I ever exposed any beloved effect that
I think you've done wonderful instructional but not in a mass media, which I hope you don't do.
No. Wait, did I not tell you where and when this would be?
I have no idea what this is.
Oh shit. Okay. I can't even talk in code in a way that people won't immediately figure out what I was.
Let's switch to Navajo.
Let me say this. There was a live event that brought me in as a I can't even say that.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah. The Lady Gaga thing. Got it.
Like, released a trailer?
No. It's not Penn & Teller's Fool Us.
Yeah.
No. This is a different thing.
Yeah,
I got to whatever. This is all post show talk.
It's all right. It's boring, anyways. Anybody, you're not missing anything.
Yeah, trust me.
Shop talk, not a cool shop. It's a shop just filled with like lint and pieces of thread and cat hair.
Hey, so real quick, one of the things that we're going through with scamstuff.com is figuring out how to make everything as approachable as possible. Like if you were. Most of the stuff on Scam Stuff is fine if you know that you're the one who ordered it and bought it for yourself. But for example, the Scam Pack, which we were really proud of, if you just gave that to someone as a gift, they would have been like, what the hell is this? It's a pint glass with some BBs on it and crap from a craft drawer. And so it's, you know, we realize like, oh, wait, we have to put in there like you are receiving a Scam Pack. It has all the things to do this. Learn over 100 tricks by doing whatever. I'm sort of wanting to give that treatment to diamondclub.tv. Like, pretend you don't know what diamondclub.tv is. And I realized that when you click on a channel, you know, it's usually just a picture of, you know, like Tinvec's face or Bryce Castillo's face or whatever, which, you know, if you're in on the inside, makes sense to everything. But it's like, I mentioned in the chat earlier, I think it would be great if it'd be like, you're watching Tinvec do blank or whatever. I just want to make everything as approachable.
Yeah, I mean,
as
like
possible.
Twitch has that auto. This person is like you enter in what game you're playing, so at the very least, like there is like a text. Willie Dills is playing Hearthstone, or you know Brian Brushwood is playing Kill All
Hearthstone
Orcs or whatever.
Yeah, Orcs Must Die.
Orcs are the scourge, and
orcs are
we'll kill them all.
Red. That's actually a good point. I don't know why I'm not getting pictures on those, but at any rate, I don't know. I'm only saying it live on the stream because I know Sergeant Muffin. I was mentioning it to Neshcom earlier, but since Sergeant Muffin's there, that was just a thought I had. Take that for what it's worth, which is nothing because I'm worth nothing and I'll never be ever anything.
Oh, Brian, don't say that.
Yeah, Hey, come on.
Your organs might be worth something someday, Brian.
That's true. Good point. I could live on through the successes of another person.
If one of your children needs like a blood donor, I think you could probably supply.
Listen, Brian, for real, like you really need to take stock at your life and understand that at the very, very least, you have left a tremendous legacy behind as being a guy who once met Chad Johnson, Twitch celebrity.
You know Chad Johnson?
Oh, yeah, well, yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know if you saw, but he was even in a scam school once. I'm going to replay the hell out of it.
I slept in his bed.
Trying to ride on his coattails.
Not at the same time.
Dude, I did sleep in Chad's bed at the same time.
Clarify that.
welcome to Dragon Con.
Oh, yes. We all slept.
There was like 8 of us in the room together. Yes.
Oh, when I write the tell-all book, guys.
like, I've woken up after a night of debauchery at Dragon Con. I look to the right. Brian Brushwood is snuggled up against Chad Johnson's body.
Chad Johnson's Johnson. That was the time when I woke up just in the middle of the night. I'm like, look at the sales of Angel Killer.
As if on cue, the moment I said that, the door swung open and Kramer poked her head in, and except it was Bonnie the Invisible Wife. all right. Hey, man, we're ready to go whenever.
Yeah. Everybody knows this is all a gay thing, right? Everybody knows this, right?
Yeah. No, we're making gay jokes.
Well, here's the funniest part about it is that really the only thing stopping this from being readily available erotica is that we are not in the same relevant sphere as Chad Johnson. Like, you know, this is like this would be regular. Like this would be actual gay fan erotica if we were in the same sphere of influence.
And by sphere of influence, you mean 15 years younger.
Yes, or appealing directly, specifically to how current 15-year-olds spend their time.
Yeah, agreed. All right, here we go. Ready? 5, 4, 3, 2.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Andrew Main. Welcome to the Weird Things podcast with my co-host, Brian Brushwood.
Yo, 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 I'm feeling it. I feel like for anyone who listened to After Things and who was tweeting us, yeah, it turns out me and Andrew were talking different timelines.
Justin Robert Young.
This is you know, I feel like you know, I didn't get enough argument in my household growing up, so that's why I do the After Things show where I can just be covering my ears while mommy and daddy yell about which one is right about future AI.
Oh man, we've gotten so much better about it though, dude. I feel like we're mellowed out severely over the last 5 years.
Oh, yeah, I mean, because like after it's like, are you like, no, like, we're brothers. This is what we do.
Oh, God, yeah. No, anybody who thought that the After Things episode last week was, you know, some kind of thing, you know, you really need to listen to some of the early episodes, which were derailed like within minute 5 and then goes to like hour 3 of just like, but I don't think that you're seeing my point, like.
The space elevator.
Yeah.
You guys, you ran over my introduction because we have to introduce the other host for today, our guest.
What?
Charlie.
Oh, okay. Now I've seen
Charlie
the
Demon. Charlie the Demon will be visiting us today.
Have you heard of this, Justin?
What in the hot ham water's going on here?
There's something. All the kids on the YouTubes are. You know. You remember the Cinnamon Challenge?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, imagine if the Cinnamon Challenge was invite a demon into your heart and see him manifest itself. Remember Captain Howdy on the Ouija board?
Sure,
turned
yeah.
out to be the devil invading Reagan? We're just going to do that now live because that's apparently what all the kids are doing.
So wait, people are trying to...
Summon a demon.
Since when did... all right. I mean, I feel like this is like... okay.
Well, it's maybe like, how the I world ends. I like... my favorite is Time. Time has on their newsfeed writes, Charlie, here's a fun thing the kids are doing these days with school supplies, using pencils to call upon an alleged Mexican demon with the Charlie Challenge, the latest internet fad. First, it was, you know, we had planking. We had, now we have summoning, you know, the legions of hell to come forward and possess us. So, what you do is okay, you take two pencils, you balance one pencil on top of the other, and you have written on cards like yes, no, no, yes, whatever. And then
well,
what
I,
you
I'm
do,
sorry, I don't have any pencils. I don't have any paper, and I certainly haven't written down. Ah, crap.
Oh,
we're
good
gonna
God.
Summon
All
a
right,
demon.
Andrew's already set up. The Charlie Challenge, which, I mean, here's the first thing I think about is how far away is Vietnam to today's youth that we can say two things with Charlie twice, and that's not the first thing people think of.
Yeah, man. Dude, who do you think invented this? Do you think this was some school kid or something? Or do you think it's somebody who had prior knowledge of how stuff like the Ouija board works?
I think the demons invented this.
Right.
And remember, you know, we have a very popular pope right now who's also talking about, who has a background in exorcism. And not to say that I have a book coming out on July 7th called Name of the Devil, which may involve similar elements to this. And this may play very well into my goal of promoting this book and getting the topic going. But,
oh, dude, I suddenly got way more excited about this. That's amazing.
But any event, you know, we do have a pope that's talked about. I don't want to get too much into the plot of my book, but let me just say that I've been like every news event, I've been like, oh, yes. Oh, I wrote that before we had the new pope. And then the new pope, I'm like, oh, he's perfect. He's perfect.
Okay.
This one will do nicely.
So right now, if you're not familiar with how to set up the Charlie Challenge, and I don't know much about the process, but I do know that you set up a left corner, upper left corner, bottom right corner are identical. And then lower left and upper right are identical outcomes, whether they're yes or no or whatever. And you balance one pencil across the other. Hopefully, if it's anything like a Ouija board, in a way where it's like it's very wobbly and maybe susceptible to, shall we say, demonic forces.
Yeah, because that's what you want to do. Demons love precarious balancing. You know, that's really where the devil's playground is things kind of balanced on other things.
Did you guys listen to the Radiolab where they talked about the dude who's
apparently fucking Charlie, I just cursed.
Yeah.
Apparently Charlie did, because it's just now pointing toward yes.
That was me blowing on it. I will, just to clarify, I don't want any deception. So you put this in balancer. So we have two pencils, one balanced on top of each other, as Brian pointed out. And it is. When I used to handle the $1 million challenge, we'd get a lot of these things where things are, if there's any movement, it's going to do something. It's going to move in one direction or the other. So I don't know if we would count it as, you know, all that, you know, supernatural. But, you know, if you're, you know, a room full of excited teenagers, you know, as we all are, and you get that, and all of a sudden you get some motion or some movement like that, it starts to move. So I'm going to try to get this.
By the way, before we do this, can we just full on hands in the air? There's a reason we do the Weird Things podcast, and it's because we've been at that sleepover where for a brief fleeting second, we truly believed we were contacting the other side, the other world. I mean, as a matter of fact, you know, speaking of the younger demographic, our tests that we performed in, was it room 707 or I forget what it was? The haunted hotel. Haunted,
you and
Chad
and,
Johnson.
Who? Oh, Chad Johnson.
OMG, Chad Johnson.
Wait, you know Chad?
Chad of Twitch fame. Yeah. Of Minecraft's own. OMG, Chad. You guys were there, and man, I'll tell you what, that we could actually get some traction on this podcast. We start pumping that to the to the Chad fans.
Oh, dude, like, we should.
He is the star of that episode. What we did is we did a lot of haunting tests, traditionally accepted a test to see whether or not some place is haunted. And this is not just about where those kids at that sleepover. We strive to continue that sleepover, every day of our lives. Any way that we can invite something that's creepy and weird and demonic into how we exist, the better I think we believe our lives to be. Andrew, can you give me a demonstration of the Charlie Challenge here?
Okay. There's a process, right, that we have to follow.
Carelessly balanced, so it's not touching either end here.
Right.
We have our cards, and now what we would do is we'd go like, Charlie, are you there? Charlie, are you there?
Should we, since Skype doesn't let us sync up, let's go in the round. Charlie, are you there?
Charlie, are you there?
Charlie, are you there?
He hasn't decided if he's there or not. Charlie! Come out of the woodwork, you asshole!
Charlie, do all dogs go to heaven?
Now, I know there might be some suspicion, you know, for me, if it were to start moving because, like, I'm over here.
Yeah, okay, so you're going to move away so you can't blow on it or nothing.
No.
Yeah. So right now, the pencil is balanced on top of the other one. Okay. And again, geez! All right,
wait,
so we just
no.
saw
so,
this
okay,
move.
You know, okay, just Andrew is nowhere near the pencil. The pencil is moving towards
no. Oh, my good God. Charlie is here. All right, so wait, Charlie's...
It's coming to no, so, okay.
Charlie is apparently a skeptic.
I think what he means Jesus Christ.
Oh, my fuck? Good God.
What more proof do we need? What more proof?
So visibly flew up from its set and removed the card from the table.
Oh, my God.
Apparently a demon far more powerful than Charlie is with us.
I'm sad we don't get to ask our questions now because he just threw.
I think he could still ask our questions, Brian.
maybe we should ask Charlie. Maybe his name's not Charlie. Maybe we got somebody. Wait, oh my God, what is happening?
For the guys,
if there's ever been a time.
Do not go widescreen, Brian.
I will not. There's a levitating, incredible, amazing pencil.
Hey, you should go back to thirds. Yeah. There we go.
All right.
So, I have no idea.
All right. So with the Charlie thing, like what demon, like, does it have a credible demonology, or is it just kind of like the Candyman or something that that you just kind of becomes a thing because people say it's a thing?
MIT studying this right now.
No. Well, but I would assume MIT's anthropologists would probably be tracking down, like, you know, where this comes from. You know, that's one of my favorite things is, you know, you go to Snopes.com and you're not surprised to find out that something's an urban legend, but I am always fascinated to find out, you know, where it came from and where it got its start.
Yeah, and nobody has done a lot of research on, I haven't seen any original research onto where it came from.
Yeah.
Which I kind of like, oh, let's see where this starts, since you'd think it'd be easy to figure it out now, but I just love a Mexican demon.
Yeah, that's...
So, a Mexican demon. I like to think of this as our manifestation of getting over the hump on immigration.
Where? I think it might be some sort of subtext that they're sneaking through.
Oh, I would love, yeah, that would be great. I would love to see that as part of like a presidential debate question. Like, why can't we get American demons back to work?
Yeah, so the as far as the physical explanation, The Independent has an article saying that when you awkwardly position the pencils, they have to move some direction due to gravity.
Us explaining kind of how this thing actually, the mechanics of it physically, is far less interesting than us either finding out what Charlie the demon kind of was doing, or if there is any lore to I feel like we should be making it up.
I am interested because I was totally wrong. I figured it would have been vibrations on the table or something blowing it, but that's not what if it's not moving
and something that starts moving, then it's because some outside force on it. And when you have a force, and we were correct, you know, it's going to have to move at some point if there's some sort of movement on it. It's Newton, guys. Demon Hunter.
Well, so what is? Can we write the Hollywood screenplay for Charlie's backstory? How does he go from being a lowly demon of no import into YouTube phenomenon?
I think that originally he was maybe some sort of Aztec demon or something.
You know? Was his name Charlie originally, or is that his Americanized?
It's Carlos. Know?
Carlos.
Yeah, it's Carlos. It's you know, and maybe he starts off as a little boy, Carlito.
Well,
you know?
If I remember correctly, he was one of the, he was slaughtered at the age of 14, as in order to make the sunrise the next day. In the afterlife, eventually figured out that, you know, maybe the sun was going to rise anyway, and he didn't need to be killed. And in fact, I believe that's what made him, as a spirit, you know, be very pro-science. That's the reason he's the internet's hottest demonic Mexican celebrity right now.
Well, you know, the thing with the Aztecs, if you're going to build a mythology around it, is, you know, they got the calendars, right?
Yep.
And there is always the idea that, like, the Aztecs had a lot of this stuff sort of figured out that we have then kind of forgotten because it is a civilization that collapsed. So you could always say that, like, they kind of set up their own little pen for these demons with, like, you know, with a time release. And now we are getting the Aztecs' final revenge as they release their demons slowly but surely onto an unsuspecting gringo populace.
Now that's interesting because I would have figured, like, if I was Charlie, maybe I would, you know, and I was an Aztec, and I'd be like, yeah, that's right, 2012, it's going to end, and then it didn't end. You know, maybe you're like, ah, crap, I got to tell people, I got to give them warnings.
Oh, that's it. Okay, so 2012 wasn't the end for society.
Right.
It was the end on the Aztecs' hold on these demons. And so now Charlie, who was a young boy,
is free.
Slaughtered for the sunrise. That's why he's interacting with the kids.
But because he died as a disenfranchised 14-year-old. He was a victim of the power play of the adult-run struggle or society at the time, and now he knows that it's like, where am I going to go to reach out? I ain't going to go to scientists. They ain't going to listen. They're going to miss the phenomenon. I'm going to go where the kids my age are, and I'm going to tell them the real truth.
You know, maybe it's like when that dude left that was at One Direction.
Zane, come on. Have some respect.
And caused all the problems. Maybe it's a parallel universe Zane trying to reach through the ether to make contact. Like, I'm still in the band.
Maybe.
Just as plausible.
By the way, wow. According to this article on the Washington Post, they have a tweets per day. Charlie challenge is zero for all of time until you get to, just this week. 523, all of a sudden, 1 million hashtags using Charlie Challenge in one day.
Mm-hmm.
That's amazing.
I think it's something amazing to see how quickly things spread, and then we'll fade away.
Okay, so apparently, it's exactly hard to pin down a country of origin, but Charlie, also known as Charlie with a Y, has a long history as a schoolyard game in the Spanish-speaking world. According to a 7-year-old Yahoo questions in Spanish thread, or Yahoo answers rather, kids have been playing this version of a classic game in Spain for years. Traditionally, this version with the cross pencils was called Juego de la Lapicera, a term that still turns up a lot of creepy stuff on Google. Charlie was a distinct game played with colored pencils. At some point, the two games seem to have merged.
I'll tell you what.
And then so some newscast in the Dominican went all panicky about it, and then that's when it spread.
Okay, and so Charlie is a child who committed suicide or the victim of a fatal car accident or a pagan Mexican deity who now convenes with the Christian devil. But then it writes, the Washington Post writes, the Mexican deity bit, at least, is demonstrably untrue.
Really?
Well, how do you know?
I mean, come on.
I mean, okay, look, you could say it's untrue or it's factually inaccurate or it cannot be backed up by evidence, but demonstrably true? Are you saying you can prove that he's not Mexican God?
Well, they
do have the word demon in demonstrably.
BBC Mundo expert Maria Elena Neves is saying there's no demon called Charlie in Mexico. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You were going door to door taking the demon census.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what they did. They had, was a whole thing that they did in 1983, I think that was right before the big election.
Yeah, the demon census. It's like, okay. And this year, the most popular demon name is Beelzebub.
For the 6,000th year in a row.
I love the authority at which we speak of make-believe.
When there's a moment for it, Justin, do you ever have that moment where it's like you're falling asleep on a plane and you have an epiphany or a thought or something and it strikes you as deep and you're like, oh, that's pretty clever. And then you fall off asleep, right?
Sure. Yeah. That is actually, I often think I have brilliant thoughts and then realize that they're nonsense.
Okay. I had one of those and then I thought it was so clever at the time. And I honestly don't know if it is. And I kind of want to hold it up for a review by you gentlemen. And it's okay. Yeah, that's fine. Preemptive thumbs down.
Andrew's
is
vigorously thumbs downing this.
and that's what I assume is that there's no way that I've had a thought before anyone else. But I wrote a letter to myself as I fell asleep. Can I read it to you guys?
Sure.
It's a bit. Yeah.
No, Brian, we're going to let you get into this much buildup and then tell you no.
Okay. So I wrote myself an email that says titled God. Okay. It says here, there's no way this is going to go bad. It says, on this flight from where I was to Austin, you had the thought regarding ubiquitous cameras and development of artificial intelligence. For 2,000 plus years, I wrote 2,000, but I think you could say what? How long has Abrahamic God been around? What, 6,000 years?
Something like that.
Yeah, so okay, so we'll say for 6,000 plus years, man has told stories of two things: an all-conscious being who watches our every move, and the promise that through them we will have life everlasting, right? And then I wrote, we've wished and wished and wished for it to be true, and now we are factually making it happen. And then I wrote, all the cameras equals all the eyes, facial recognition equals interpretation. And then I wrote the more vaguely worded, the human plus AI inspired healthcare work equals everlasting life, or as close as we can get to it. And then I followed it up with an explanation to myself, just in case I forgot. I said, to put it more simply, man is building God. And then I wrote something about Isaac Asimov's Final Question, which by the way, if you haven't read it, is the short story, the final question about the nature of entropy, and an AI is tasked with trying to figure out if it's ever possible to solve entropy. And there's a clever ending to it. If you haven't read it, stop what you're doing right now. In fact, preemptively, my pick is Isaac Asimov's The Final Question. I don't know. There was something I thought.
Is that the last question?
Oh, is it the last question? Maybe. Yes, I bet that is. Asimov's The Last Question. I'm searching that. Yeah, there we go. That's what it is. Yeah, the multivax. Yes. As a matter of fact, if you do a search right now for The Last Question by Isaac Asimov, copyright 1956. But I thought it was fascinating. Like, in the 1600s, you could say you're being watched at all times, and absent a belief, you know, let's say if you're a full-on atheist during that time, you would just not believe it. There wouldn't be anything to it. And, you know, you would steal or rob or whatever with impunity, knowing that you weren't really being watched. But nowadays, there's nothing you can get away with where there's not a camera somewhere. And so one half of the presuppositions is already true and becoming more true by the moment. And then the other half, like the life everlasting, that seems to me to be the singularity. That's the goal of everybody working on you know, our bodies and minds being able to be these transportable vessels that live forever, right?
That's been, and also one of the biggest criticisms of the singularity is the idea that it seems to fulfill some sort of Judeo-Christian idea of heaven or, you know, that. You're right to your thoughts, Brian.
Well, and keep in mind, these are the musings of somebody, you know, inches from falling asleep on a Southwest Airlines flight. So I'm not going to pretend it's high thought, but I'm so glad I wrote myself, because I had totally forgotten about it. I got home, I was like, why did I write myself about God? I was like, oh wow, that's interesting.
Well, you know, and it's back in the 90s, Frank Tipler wrote a book. Frank Tipler's a physicist. And he wrote a book, I think, called The Physics of Immortality. And it was the idea, and he was postulating that if you took a wormhole and you spun it, you know, you could create basically the idea that you could capture every bit of information that ever had. You could observe everything that ever happened historically prior to or whatever and all that. And then you could resurrect everybody who ever died. And there are a lot of problems with that thesis, you know, information loss, whatever. And you find, you know, you get periodically, you get that, as you pointed out, you get, and now it's the Physics of Christianity, or, you know, he wrote Physics of Immortality, which came before that, if you look at Tipler's previous books. And, it, you know, he was a Christian trying to reconcile, a very devout Christian trying to, there you go, Physics of Immortality, trying to reconcile his beliefs with his wanting to believe or scientifically justify the idea of there being an afterlife, or how we could create it or whatever. You know, and it's an interesting premise. The first thing I ever tried to write back a long time ago, years and years ago, was I wrote a book called Heaven is a Hard Drive, because it was, you know, reading Wired magazine in the 90s. I was excited about the whole idea of, and reading Singularity was just a tiny little notion, but all the nanotechnology stuff was exciting. And that was sort of, you know, that was one of the things that fueled that. And it, you know, it gets to be this exciting notion, but then you have to separate What is God? What is heaven? And what is God over time? Remember, God wasn't always all powerful. God used to be one of many gods. And then we kept, as we rewrote the narrative, it became, no, there's just one God. Right. Charlie's not a god. And does this like, sound like a good thing to you?
You got to top the original and the sequel, right? You know, yeah. you got to make it more powerful.
And like, then you retcon. Then it gets retconned, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And at some point, God is Gwen Stacy.
Well, so to the heart of my thought, as I was falling asleep on a Southwest Airlines flight, like, do you think there's something to be said that well, yeah, let's say we see the point. Yeah, the singularity is man's attempt to make true this inherent and universal desire to be immortal. I mean, do you think that's
unreasonable? Yes and no. I mean, I think that no matter what, there is certainly an undeniable impact that art and narratives have on our lives and on innovation and on, you know, like our, at the very least, our understanding and our quantification of technology. But the question is, how hard are we kind of working overtime to sort of plug this one thing into this other thing, no matter how awkwardly it might fit?
I mean, the argument can be made that every technology is the push towards preservation of life, and then the end goal is immortality. You know, developing a spear to defend yourself or to hunt and food, you know, eat and do that. Everything is sort of towards that goal of living longer and healthier and all that. Your observation about the cameras and stuff is interesting, because that sounds terrifying and spooky. And, you know, I would very much, you know, I loved in some of the Dune books, they got into the idea of like having rooms that just could not be observed.
Right. Well, and making thinking machines illegal, you know, banning them, you know, and that's the thing. And I don't know if we've talked about this on Weird Things. Like, people are aware that facial recognition is becoming ubiquitous and making it possible so that you could track someone in their real-time movements at all time now. Given enough cameras and a smart enough AI with enough access, we could follow someone from point A to point B, everywhere.
Or can you?
Yeah, well, he says with a rubber band masking his features.
Ow. This is great.
but here's what I don't think people realize is that that's going to be retroactive as well. You know, there's going to be a time when we will go back through, let's say, politically polarizing figures, let's audience shots of Malcolm X, speeches. You're going to be able to go and say like, oh, that's current Secretary of State so-and-so that was definitely there at that place at that time. And so it's like, suddenly, not only do we have to worry about what we're doing now, but there's like an incoming reckoning for what we've done in the past. As think about it, AIs are going to be able to analyze everything we've ever written and be able to say, well, this came out 2 weeks after whatever and was definitely influenced by this, which he almost certainly saw. And like, as robots get smart enough to analyze everything and we become reduced to the sum of our algorithms, I don't know. It's amazing to me. I think there's a weird coming reckoning, and what for 6,000 years people had been told will be factually demonstrably true moving in that direction.
I mean, if I were a theologian, I would say that their idea of God and joy and all these other things, you know, isn't so much about knowing as much as experience or something. Are you familiar with the Conjuring Arts Research Center project, Ask Alexander?
Yes, I've heard of it. I haven't played around with it a lot.
So for those of you out there, what they did is Will Kalush, really neat guy. They have a Conjuring Arts Research Center. What they did is he has a humongous collection of magic books and historical items. They've taken all of these books and then they've have people gone through and itemized what's in there. And not just books, like Houdini's contracts, you know, Houdini posters, things like that. And they've assembled this database so they could they used it for Houdini to reconstruct a timeline of where he was, you know, throughout, you know, where was he, you know, on September 2nd, 1922. And it might say, oh, we think he was in New York at this time, whatever. And it's an amazing thing they're able to do and take these historical person and all these other bits of magic and be able to trace the history of that.
So, for the record, it is Will Kalush who, in part, assembling all of this kind of stuff with the Conjuring Arts Research Center, wrote a book about Houdini, and with some very interesting ideas of what he was actually up to, and also how he died with a tremendous timeline that is not officially recognized.
Yeah, it doesn't really do like plain language queries, but it has this data there, and they're from there able to draw this up. And you know, you see that now with Facebook doing creepy things with your timelines and stuff. You know, this is your year, and we're gonna put this music and make it feel really effing special. I hate those things. Oh,
well, that's just because they're poorly executed right now. I think they're gonna get better and better. I mean, eventually the robots will figure out what you like, and they will cater to it.
I listen. Different person, different strokes, different folks. I think it will
always be the treacly Hallmark card of its era, right? And like, there are some people who aren't really into super treacly Hallmark exactly. cards right now. They're weird, like pre-printed versions that think that they know more about you than they might know, or are more suited for different demos, because there's a lot of people. I mean, like, I have no doubt that those are best suited for the average use case of Facebook, and I don't think any of us are that.
I'm not a cinema guy. I don't collect stuff of where I've been or what I do and all that. The only record of the past I really have is my email and my photo album and my iPhone. You know, and so like when I'm like, oh, this was last year was like, I don't care. Next year is what's important to me. So
if they put together a group of Photoshops of what you're going to be doing in the next year, you'd be more interested in it.
Then I don't have to do it.
Well, that's like you on Mars.
Something that's really creepy and weird. I mean, I'm creepy. Like, so now, if it's somebody's birthday, like on Facebook, you can just type in "I" and it'll autofill like "Happy birthday" to the person.
Yeah, but there's an arms race there, right? Where it's like, I make sure never to do that. And in fact, if I get reminded that it's somebody's birthday, I will usually try to call them on the phone directly so that they know that I care and that I recognize it.
We didn't get a call.
Except for somebody I hate. I apologize. I did see that it was your birthday, and I just got distracted.
All you had to do was type I.
No, but see, that I would not do. Oh, man. That I would not do, because that would come across as a perfunctory, you know, because you would
better
know.
Better to do nothing? Better to do nothing?
Well, no. Better doing... Okay. You want a back rub? I'll give you a back
rub.
What was
that? Something about best intentions.
Well,
you will finish.
Carry on the conversation. Just carry on.
No, but like, there's an awareness, right? Like, when somebody just, you know, says exactly happy birthday, you'll know, because you were given that option, that is a, you know, the lowest level indication of interest you can give. I don't know.
Yeah, no, it's weird. And Tensor Guy, yeah, I didn't reply because I'm not going to spend my birthday replying to all of everybody's birthday wishes. So there.
This segment took a weird turn.
Thank you. Well, that's the weird thing too, is you start getting like, "Hey, happy birthday, happy birthday," and you're like, "I want to respond to that stuff." You know, it's a weird thing. It's like, I would rather wish somebody a happy birthday. I don't need them to acknowledge that I wished them a happy birthday, because I want to imagine they're out having fun and not sitting at home, you know, watching.
Exactly. Where you're like, dude, 30 for 30s. I clapped, you know, it's like the play doesn't end and then someone goes around and thanks each person who clapped for it. You know,
But Brian, you touched on a very good point. So it's like with the Facebook thing, and like, you know, the next step is have my bot wish your bot a happy birthday, you know, and it gets into this very weird area.
But here's the other thing, right, is there's almost a value to that, because then we get to an escalation where it's like, hey, this person seems to be interested. He's asking for a special favor, wants to come beyond scam school. Hey, bot, what's my relationship with that one? It's like, well, you guys have swapped pleasantries 37 times over the last 2 years. They've always reciprocated, and they, independent of your request, have shared 57 of your whatevers. We give them a trustworthy rating of 75%, and we're willing to label them as a true fan of Scam School. Where our analysis is that it would be a good idea to have them on, and they would be a good fit. And I was like, great, go ahead and book it, have their bot schedule everything and get it on. Like, none of that bothers me. I'm totally cool with that, because you know what? That's the way CEOs act today. And it's like, if all of us had the power of CEOs, then we would get a hell of a lot more done.
I would say that there is a, and it's a way a lot of mutual funds perform too, and they perform less than the average, you know. And I think that there is a place for that. I absolutely think there's a place for that. But, you know, it's like I just read an article talk about the Myers-Briggs test and how much BS it is, you know. But this is a thing used by 90% of the Fortune 100 companies because, well, it's a thing. It's a major thing. It's a thing. It says that we can do this sort of thing. And I'm all for this as long as, you know, we don't give up. Well, let's ask critical questions. Let's not invest too much in the model. We need to stop and take apart the models every now and then. But as the more we invest in, it gets scary. I'm all for everything, but let's not forget how to be human.
All right, here. Let's do the Patreon plug.
Okay.
I want to see whether or not we want to get into a conversation about the Myers-Briggs test, because I know that Brian has recently, and not to say that, you know, he is a defender of it, but has recently become fascinated with the Myers-Briggs.
Yes, I think that's an accurate way to put it.
But let's talk about the Patreon. Patreon.com/weirdthings is where you go if you'd like to support this show. We are trying to create for you interesting and hopefully equal parts silly and informative programming each and every week. I'll tell you this. Because of you, the patrons to this show, we just cashed out since we have started, and I am putting every dime of what I got paid personally to a brand new rig that will not only benefit this show, but also everything else that we do. That is Weird Things money at work.
You know what? I'll double down on that. I called Justin this afternoon as somebody who has reconfigured his entire household in order to accommodate his live streaming and stuff. I called him up and I said, Bonnie had a nutty idea that I discounted out of hand. But the more I looked at it, the better it looked. I think we're going to blow a lot of money to move this studio, to rebuild it from scratch and move it down to the master bedroom, where we'll get like 30 more square feet of space that will have higher ceilings and better ventilation. It'll solve the overheating. It'll be away from the girls downstairs. We're going to rebuild all of this from scratch. And it's because of what feels like found money to us from, you know, doing the Weird Things podcast, because, you know, we of course did it for 5 years free, and it's awesome that we're getting paid. My only request is, come on guys, we're $20 away for being at $666.66 per episode. Tell me we can make this happen.
Everybody, a dollar and no more, right? Like, we can't screw with the cents part about this. That's really the key. So we just need 20 people to give $1 per episode.
Or 40 people to do 50 cents. That'd work too, because then we'd be at over 500 patrons.
You want to know? I'm not. Yeah, we can't risk it.
Can't risk it. Okay, we just need 20. In fact, what should we call the 20 honorable souls who step forward in the next week?
Those who walk the left-hand path.
Those who walk the left-hand path. Are you one of those who walk the left-hand path? Mark it. On 5/31/2015, the challenge was issued. We're looking for 20 brave souls to walk the left-hand path.
And by the way, a dollar does get you the After Things show early, so you are able to listen to it as soon as it is posted and complete, which, by the way, happens because we now have a producer who has done such an amazing job on this show that Brian and I finally made the decision that we probably should have made like roughly a year and a half ago to bring Bryce on for Night Attack as well. He is amazing. This is great. You are great. Why don't we all be great together? Patreon.com/weirdthings.
And if we go over 666, we're okay with that.
I mean, hey, listen.
One step at a time, bro.
I mean, that just means we're more metal than the devil. So, you know, in your face.
The devil's shaking his horned fists down below us. We're like, oh, I only made it to 666, you.
Do we want to engage in a quick Myers-Briggs conversation?
I think it's interesting. For those of you who I took a seminar, and part of it was, you know, take the Myers-Briggs test. I think you are 100% right, Andrew. By the way, Justin took the Myers-Briggs test as well. I think you're 100% right, Andrew, in that it's certainly, its reputation is deservedly besmirched among CEOs who think that they can take people and treat them like cogs and move them around according to pseudoscientific arbitrary things. But the context in the workshop that I took was, you know, how to communicate more effectively with someone who maybe sees the world differently than you. And, you know, for example, you know, let's just take the extrovert to introvert thing. There are definitely some people, extroverts, who derive energy from talking to other people. And there's other people, introverts, for whom talking is distracting from the thinking, and it takes energy. I guess the Myers-Briggs test strikes me as a valuable test, just like a test asking what's your favorite color is. Yes, you could take the same test 5 times, and 50% of the time you'll come up with a different color, especially, you know, over time or maybe even day to day. But if you plan to use that to put people in a job, that's a dumb way to do it. However, if you plan to use that test to tell a painter what color to paint your room, then it's probably an accurate test.
My issue with it comes from a couple things. One is the data. You know, when they have people take retest with it 3 weeks, 4 weeks later, you know, 50% or more people don't score. They score completely different. That's one problem with it. So it's like, its unreliability is a big flag. My second thing is that I'm all for, if it's just, we're just talking about introverted, extroverted sort of types, you know, it's very helpful to understand that. But when they have, there's several false dichotomies they put in there that are demonstrably, the research says, no, that is not the way it works. Thinking, feeling. You're either the thinking or you're feeling. That is not the way it works. We know that from all the psychological research now, that to split it and to say you're the this or you're that, as Myers-Briggs does, is harmful.
Well, and I think that might be a mischaracterization, because there's certainly a spectrum between the two, and I don't think they say you're either one or the other. I think they say, you know, because like handedness, you could be ambidextrous, you could be lean more one way to the other. Like the example that I heard on thinking versus feeling, and we talked about this on a 9 attack, was, you know, if you're the kind of person, you know, thinking when it comes to buying a car would be the type of person who does all the research, prints out all the comps, finds what's available right now used on Craigslist, marches into the auto dealership and says, I want this model at this price and this color, and I want to pay, you know, this and not a penny more. And if you don't do it, this is the alternative car I plan to buy. And then they sell it to you for $5 over invoice. Whereas a feeling-based person might say, you know, who do I trust the most when it comes to cars? I trust Ron. Ron knows more than anyone else. I'm going to call Ron. Ron, I need a new car, and you're the expert in cars. Can you look out? And then, you know, Ron, you know, be, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, my in-laws are very much feeling-based purchasers on that spectrum. And I do believe it's different, because I would never consider buying a thing because I trust the guy who tells me it's a good idea to buy it. You know, it's like it would... On that spectrum, I feel like I would come down thinking. So I don't know.
Well, I'm going to send you a link, which I'm sending to Bryce too. We should put up. It's worth reading. It's from Psychology Today.
Okay.
And it's a psychologist goes through over there and kind of basically eviscerates that and gets into where this is very counter to the research from what we understand now. And again, I don't think it's you know. Astrology that it's complete, but I think there's enough utility in parts of it is why it's been carried on. But I think that I remember when I was a kid in school and I got diagnosed with one of the fad sort of ways of telling kids what you are.
Yeah.
And that became a thing that I believed about myself. And then it wasn't until I was 20 that I said, no, I can change and I can be different. And I became a radically different, you know, I developed study habits that they said that I did not possess and could not possess, you know, and that's my fear about many of these things, is because we are extremely predictable. There's a lot of data that shows this to us, but there is an industry of people who don't get science, who don't get these things, who love science, who talk about it, but don't get it, who will put out this, promulgate this BS for whatever sort of reasons, and it can be very damaging. And that's my concern.
Yeah, I don't know. When it comes to communication, I would say at the worst case, you could make a case that that certainly the fetishization of this test is akin to neurolinguistic programming, you know, which is full on pseudoscientific. However, at the end of the day, you know, reading up on neurolinguistic programming and concepts like mirroring, basically boils down to a structure of how is this person positioned himself? You know, what's their posture? What does their posture maybe indicate about what they're thinking? If I mirror, you know, to use the neurolinguistic programming nonsense term for it, you know, their posture or their volume or whatever, if I try to match their energy, and again, there's no such thing as energy between people, but as a shorthand, you know, it's sort of like no matter how faddish your diet is, if you're paying attention, if you're paying more attention to what you eat while you're on the fad diet than you were when you weren't on it, then you're probably going to be stepping in the right direction.
Well, there was interesting research on mirroring, and they actually did a study to find out how effective that was and what happened. And they looked in clinical situations where they had people trying to apply it, and they found it was counterproductive. The people doing it, because some people were very good at it, but most people were not, and the people who were most people were not, and it was actually having a counterproductive effect towards
because they came off as disingenuous.
Because it was annoying to people. They were irritated by this or whatever. But because the practitioners were convinced, no, this is a thing, this is a real thing, you know, it ended up being a kind of thing where, you know, they defended it because no, this is I was taught this, and it's another thing where it's like we gotta keep asking questions, and it's like, and I think. And I think with Myers-Briggs, I'm sure that probably 25 or 30% of the people, they're going to be pretty steady, you know, throughout when they get measured by that. But it's that danger of that, you know, we got to stop and go, is it worth it? Is it worth it? Is it we're doing it because it's convenient? But
And I think that there is certainly in something like the fetishization is not high, like totally unconnected from the how we understand it is valid and how valid we understand it, right? Like if it is looked at in the same way that like you said, like what's your favorite color or like a BuzzFeed personality quiz is looked at, then it is less likely to be harmful to somebody's career, to their life, to their or even their self-esteem or understanding of themselves.
Well, so let me turn it around. Let's say nobody ever takes the test, but instead you look at the framework, and you look at again, we'll do the E to I, the extroverted and introverted. It was extremely valuable for me to figure out that introverted people don't it is better to communicate with them. You will get better results. You will tax them less if you even though I would prefer to talk everything out on the phone, let's bang around ideas, let's see what bubbles up. You know, when you look at someone, you're like, oh, that person's definitely on the introverted side. For example, you know, Brant came in as an introvert, and I realized like, oh, I could do Brant a real favor by not calling him on the phone, but instead thinking out what it is I want to say and sending him a text, and he will appreciate that because I will not be taxing him. Like I don't know that was a bad realization for me to have. I don't know
that's not Myers-Briggs is one of many tests that says, oh, we'll put a thing in there for that. You know, and the most popular one is the MMPI, which is a lot better and it's more comprehensive. And the problem with inherent flaws of Myers-Briggs is put together people who lump things together, not based on science, but what they thought they intuited. It talking about introversion, extroversion, those are great things. Those are great things. That's not, I mean, Myers-Briggs, you know, every Scientology claims to measure these things. All these sort of things, you know, say that they deal with those subjects. So, yes, I'm all for yes. Understanding people who do have personality types, I'm all for that. I do believe there are types. I do think these things are real. I'm saying is Myers-Briggs, as a measure of it, is not, you know,
I think that's actually good. Granted, this is not a field for which I have found myself, in a particular interest to kind of chase down information by myself. But I would have been more likely to think that Myers-Briggs was the closer to the only game in town when it came to stuff like this if we had not had this conversation. So it's good to know.
Yeah. Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Did I just hear the General Lee? Dixie thing
in my head, maybe.
It was really weird. Maybe I just had an audio hallucination. I thought I heard da 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 da. That was really weird.
So
No. I'm not. And what's funny is like I don't know if it's like maybe there's an ad on one of the you know 15 different open tabs that did it on something's turned down or whatever.
I went for my walk last night and I saw some car squeal, and I saw some other car get upset, and this guy was in the back of this other car, was very, very frustrated with the car that cut him off, and it's this old VW van, really cool in van, right? And I see this angry face, and he goes to honk his horn, and it's...
It's like when Homer's designing the car for Danny DeVito. He goes, I want a horn here, I want a horn here, and I want a horn here, and I want them all to play La Cucaracha.
Yeah. So it was hilarious because I saw this angry guy hitting his horn like, yeah, that horn ain't so effective now, is it, buddy?
Hey, man.
Charlie, do you hear the General Lee?
Dude, do you guys want to do picks? Because I'm conflicted. I don't know what to pick.
We'll do picks. We'll do picks. I got lots of picks.
Do you?
I got picks for days.
Well, what's your pick?
Show me your picks.
So I have been going through ESPN's 30 for 30s.
What? Because you're a big sports fan.
I am. Brian, sports are like video games to me. I enjoy. I just have to keep them away from me because then it becomes
an obsession.
You know,
sure.
I mean, some things. I mean, I wouldn't watch a baseball game on TV, but I would absolutely go see a baseball game in person. You know, that it's a different experience. Like, the one that I enjoyed, one I thought was very interesting was a really nice, you know, was really well done was You Don't Know Bo about Bo Jackson. And I didn't pick it because, you know, he's, you know, went to Auburn like my brother and played for Auburn like my brother did. No, I picked it because, you know, Bo Jackson was one of these guys that was all of a sudden he's on the scene. This is a guy that's a football player. This guy's a baseball player. This guy, all the stories about what an incredible natural athlete he was. Fascinating sort of guy. And then he gets an injury and he's out of the game, out of both, you know, and he's one of those, what would have happened if he'd been able to keep, you know, developing, and it's sort of interesting, but then they talk to him and he's a very interesting guy. You know, he's, you know, a bow hunter. They talk to him. He's a very, some jocks you talk to, like, I mean, the Brian Bosworth one, was really good too. Cause that was, you got to see Bosworth back in the day when he is just the Infant Terrible. And then you got to see him today where he's embarrassed by his behavior and he doesn't want his son, you know, emulating this or whatever. And you see that, you know, athletes, pro athletes, they start at 18 years old when the rest of us are given the chance to mature in privacy.
Yep.
Where these guys are out there in front of everybody and every stupid thing they do is put out there. And so, but Bojack was very interesting to see.
By the way, real
guy.
Quick on the Brian Bosworth thing, he lives in Austin, and my trainer like 2 months ago was casually looked over, like, and he's like, hey, do you remember Brian Bosworth? And I was like, yeah, like, that's him. Apparently, we work out at the same gym now, which is
nice.
Messed
pretty cool.
Up.
Wow. Yeah, that's an awesome county outside of Austin. Yeah. You've Alex Jones and Brian Bosworth.
Yeah.
Probably interesting to say hello.
yeah, I should have, but it was in the middle of things.
Tell you
yeah.
what, I think that's a very interesting F, Mary Kill.
Yes. Well, and you could also throw Jesse James, former former husband to
Sandra Bullock.
Sandra Bullock, yeah. I believe I've been told lives just down the street from Alex Jones, just around the corner from where I live.
Yeah. Another great documentary in that same ilk of like understanding exceptional athletes, the psyche, and how varied where they come from and how they are transformed by it is the Marinovich Project. About a maniacal father who made his son into the perfect quarterback, or tried to, and kind of the psychological damage that went into that. But back to Bo, not only was Bo Jackson an exceptional athlete, but what this documentary does a very good job of explaining was really, you know, in stories, you know, you always, you know, in like the best sequels are the ones that kind of take this universe that you knew and then expanded it. And you realize, oh, my Lord, there's so much more that we can understand about this. Bo Jackson was a tipping point of A, not only like what a freak athlete he was, that mass media was there to distribute it, but also what being a star athlete meant in the modern era and one that we take for granted. But the idea of him being a cross pop culture celebrity at the level that he was to make the money that he did. You know, he had a run, had, you know, a very public run-in with the NCAA, which is still stuff
That's what the story I heard that I thought the 30 for 30 would be about is there was a Freakonomics episode talking about the game theory that went into him getting disqualified. Some pro team wanted him early. They wanted him out. They wanted him now. Yeah. So they gave him a flight, and he went out and did it and came back like, yeah, anyway, I went and checked out their stuff. They're like, wait, you accepted all that? He's like, yeah. They're like, Bo, I'm sorry. You're out. And then the team was like, ah, well, don't worry, you didn't graduate. We'll have you on. And instead, he held that grudge and did not appreciate getting played, and it shaped his entire career from there.
He was, tremendous amount of integrity. It looks like I guess when he was a high school baseball player, Steinbrenner wanted to recruit him and offered money. And then his mom's got like 10 kids. She's like, we don't need your money. Bo doesn't want to do this. She wanted to see him like finish high school and do this sort of thing. And to be able to say that is incredible. And then when, he got screwed over by Tampa, he's like, if Tampa recruits me, I am playing. I will not play. I don't care about the money. I will not play.
Yep.
Principled, how principled that he is. That is amazing to me. And you see him when they talk to him today, and he's still, he's a guy that is a lot deeper than, you would expect out of an athlete, and a guy that's such a natural athlete that had so many, gifts in that way.
He's a guy who lived, if you've ever heard about the ultimatum game, a psychological, tool to measure, how generous, people are feeling at any given time. He had a real life situation with the ultimatum game where he was offered money, it was take it or leave it, and he just walked. He's like, I'll go play another sport, get lost.
Yeah. He also, and they touch on this, and I think if they're it's the reason why I love the age that we live in, where it's like this will not be the only contemplative look at Bo Jackson we have in our entire life, just because there's so much time and effort that can go into creating this sort of content. But they touch on the idea that Bo is very like Bo can, has constructed this kind of Paul Bunyan like sort of myth around himself, even now, that like there's no it's not an accident that this documentary spends a lot of time with him being this this mythic guy in the woods, who's still, just this huge, powerful human being, like shooting boars with his, bow and arrow. He just still has this sort of larger than life sort of persona to him. But there is an element of you kind of wonder exactly, not to question Bo Jackson's principles or anything like that, but how much of a narrative he shaped, which, by the way, makes him more of the, the father of the modern athlete than almost, anything else that he's done. And also, it's worth it to watch just Bo Jackson highlights, man. Yeah. You just go on YouTube and just watch Bo Jackson highlights. Even as a non-sports fan, it will blow your face off.
After he was sidelined, he went back to Auburn and finished his degree. He went back and did that. I think he's very, a very interesting guy the story after, I'm always fascinated, like what happens after and where do these people go from there? And he's a very interesting guy. Cause you think, I think he seems like he's happy being Bo.
Dude, I don't know what to do. I have three picks. One is a pick that I ain't even seen yet.
Pick one of your picks.
What's that?
Pick one of your. I haven't seen Mr. Robot yet, so don't pick that.
Okay, well, that's all right. Okay,
I'm helping you here. I'm sorry.
Okay, all right.
Here.
Let's
Brian,
talk about.
Let me narrow one down for you. How dare you, sir?
Okay, well, for those of you who thought my pick would have been Mr. Robot, you should know that you can watch Mr. Robot. It's a premiering next month on USA Network of all places. I loved it, and I don't think I'm going to tell you anything about it except for in the first 3 minutes you'll see that it's smart. It treats the subject of hacking with integrity and in a realistic, believable way. I found it had.
I see it.
What's that?
Is it like online somewhere?
It's online. They premiered it on there. It's commercial free. Just search for Mr. Robot. Christian Slater is in it, and a bunch of other folks that I didn't recognize. It's good. It's good. It's so good. I'm gonna rewatch the whole thing again. The reason it showed up on my radar is somebody sent me a tweet to the IMDb where it had like a ridiculous like 9.2 out of 10 rating, and I was like, all right, I'll take a bite, and it's well deserved. It's Fight Club the series, basically. I dug it, but that will not be my pick because Andrew hasn't seen it. What about you? What about you guys? Have you guys seen the Kung Fury, the 30-minute final delivered movie?
I haven't seen the whole thing. Am I going to get more out of it than what I got from the trailer, which is very clever, and the video, which is very clever? But.
It's exactly the pacing of the trailer for 30 minutes straight. You get a smirk every 10 seconds. You get a laugh or a smile every 30 seconds. It doesn't overstay its welcome. It gets in and gets out, and that's it. 30
yeah,
minutes.
Yeah, no, it is. I will say that it is. It does cleverly continue to add little twists to it. That it is not just kind of let's take 80s action plus video games of the era and mash it up. There is a funny script to it that is just kind of a funny script.
It's amazing how you're able to talk to us from 1999.
Yeah, it's on his dial-up
connection.
I'm in my
watercolor world. I have no idea what the hot hell is happening.
It's like
no, that's fine.
Real Networks player. Brian, I sent you a link to the original Hacker Drama, which is a pretty high bar to pass.
Let's see. The original Hacker Drama here. Oh, my God.
This was the thing that inspired me as a kid.
Here, let me throw this on right here. Let's take a look at Andrew's original Hacker Drama. The Whiz Kids TV opening theme.
Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. God, I vaguely remember this.
Dude, that was like, I was going to get myself my little portable Timex Sinclair or Trash 80, whatever, and I was going to hack things, and I was going to disrupt the system, man. And
dude, that's then you would have loved that moment in Kung Fury when they hacked time. Did you see that scene?
In the trailer. He did magic, too. He did magic. So look up Whiz Kids opening theme.
All right, so none of that's my pick. My pick is a show that I have not yet seen, but that I trust will be amazing. And it's on my favorite channel, given the fact that we're flooding constantly right now in Texas. On the Weather Channel.
Three scientists walk into a bar.
I want you guys to check out Three Scientists Walk Into a Bar, starring your friend of mine, Anthony Carboni, Tara Long, and I don't know the third guy. But it just looks like they had a blast shooting this thing. If you liked hard science from our friends over at Revision 3 on Discovery Digital, then the spirit of that is very much alive in Three Scientists Walk Into a Bar.
Tara explains really cool things.
It basically is completely solid.
Kiss. And then I do really stupid things.
Kiss.
I lit my hand on fire.
Huh? There you go. See, that's all you need. Looking forward to it. Should be coming out, I believe, this week.
Tonight.
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 Right on. Dude, I'm going to watch that tonight.
On the Weather Channel, Three Scientists Walk Into a Bar. I think there's like a block of it. It's like 3 hours or something.
Yeah, dude. I am very, very excited. And congratulations to Anthony Carboni. This is very
cool. Oh, yeah. No, big, big shout out to him. It looks really, really funny. And I'll tell you what, I remember when I did the We Have Concerns show, it was right after he had come back from shooting it, and he was very, very excited at what they'd done.
Well, and I don't want to speak out of class, but the release schedule is not what I had heard the release schedule is going to be, which maybe suggests that that Weather Channel's so excited about it that they just want it out sooner than they originally intended it for it to be. Which is doubly awesome if that's
we
true.
All know about the very studied and staid logic of television scheduling. Am I right, people? LOL. My pick is a pick that was made here by Andrew a couple weeks ago. I watched the first half of the Grim Sleeper documentary on HBO. It is exceptional. I'm looking forward to finishing it. What I love the most about it, without totally rehashing everything that we talked about before, I love documentaries that kind of just get into it. And this is a documentary that spends very little time you know, like Andrew and I very often kind of have these conversations about nonfiction books that, you know, spend, you know, there's like the first chapter is kind of about what you really want the book to be about. And then the next seven chapters are all about, you know, for I Love for Lucille Ball, the first chapter is about the invention of the television and how, you know, exciting it was and everything. And oftentimes documentaries, just because if you want to stretch it into a feature length story, you very often, you know, if it's about South Central Los Angeles, you got to do 15 minutes about, you know, what South Central Los Angeles was and where, and it was an orange grove before the first settlers of the, like this gets kind of right into the heart of it. And any kind of explanation that it has to the region is tied directly to the story. And more importantly, the people. It is a story about people, which is, you know, very much kind of what makes it something, something special about, you know, community, race, class, police, violence, gender. It's a lot of those things without putting any of those really in capital letters and distracting from what is a tremendously chilling narrative. So check it out.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear your thoughts on it, because it is that is in watching the 30 for 30s, you know, when you watch a bunch of documentaries back to back, you're able to sometimes separate when the content is interesting versus the way it's presented does justice to it. You know, there's on HBO, and I recommend, and I'll talk about this in the after things. We'll get into Banksy Does New York. The one that like left me the most cold of 30 for 30 was Jordan Rides the Bus. You know, and I thought like, man, it was, you know, it's 50 minutes long and it felt twice as long as it for what they wanted to cover.
Yeah.
You know, it was just the same people saying the same thing. When like, man, there can be a very interesting narrative there about, you know, the legacy, you know, the idea of the legacy and this and that. And it just kind of like, yeah, you went into baseball. Guess what? Started to get better. And then he, you know, strike and then he was gone, you know, and it's like, well, you know, there's, I don't know. But, Brian, to your point earlier, you talked about, you know, when you're able to go back and look at footage and see stuff. And watching the Corbin's documentary on the U and the U part two about the University of Miami is, you know, they never mentioned he only comes up once, and that's in the U part two is The Rock, you know, where, yeah, you know, they show him giving a $1 million check. But when you watch the part one, in one moment, you see a bunch of people celebrating, and there you see a young Rocky Johnson, you know, cheering on one of his, no attention, nothing said, to be like, there's The Rock. Oh, yeah. You know, that's the thing that I forgot at this time, you know, the 1991 around that era, he was playing for University of Miami.
Wow. And that, by the way, is the great counterpoint to, you know, that the Bosworth, especially because they have an interaction with Bosworth where so many of those U alumni are very proud of the legacy that they set up. And maybe not every stitch of their actions, but certainly the anti-authoritarian streak toward the NCAA and some of the powerhouses that they thumbed their nose at look a lot better in 2015 than maybe they even did in the late 80s and early 90s, you know, considering the reputation of the NCAA and programs like Notre Dame and Penn State.
I'm just waiting for the Seventh Floor Crew to release another, you know, song.
They covered that in the U part two, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my God. Seventh Floor Crew. If Your Girl Only Knew.
Yeah, it's over my head.
G-Reg. The seventh floor was where the athletes dorm, and they decided one day to, there was a project where they would get, each one would record a rap, you know, part of a rap song. And it's a very accurate depiction of what it's like to be a baller at a university like University of Miami. And it's very extremely vulgar, and it came out, it was super controversial, and they got in trouble for it because it was, you know, like, you know.
Well, yeah, it came out, I think, about a year after half of them had already left, you know, but it was, yeah, it's, I mean, listen, the one of the most visible boosters in the history of the University of Miami program is Luther Campbell of Two Life Crew. So it is very much in the vein of Uncle Luke's body of work. And it delighted me to no end. I remember when it came out, and it still brings a smile to my face.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Gentlemen, it's been weird.
Dude, that was a good one.
Yeah, summon like demons. That kind of thing.
What's that?
you like that kind of thing.
Yeah. You're into like good content or something.
No.
Hey, whatever, guys.
Yeah, way to keep things moving quickly and on topic.
Yeah,
and,
you know.
Yeah, nice insights.
I'm going to use a restroom.
Yeah, I am too. But I'm going to use a different restroom than yours, just so we're clear.
Yeah, let's cross the streams, Brian.
Then there was just me, guys. Hey, my name's Justin, and I'm here on the stream by myself. What's going on? You know, I'll tell you what. Today has just been a haunted day here in the studio, technology-wise. You know, we had that internet fart at the end of the show, and Ashley sure as hell had a hell of a time trying to do the new version of Church with your old pal John Teasdale. Hey, let me ask you guys something. So we're putting together a list here for the contender, and what I want to do is keep a list for people that are interested in it, that want to be notified when we do a Kickstarter, and also possibly have like a little mini list for some print and play beta testing. Yeah, this is for the contender. This is a card game I'm putting together with John Teasdale and Megan Fawn of Guts and Glory. We are really, really, really excited about it. By the way, you can follow it. I set up an Instagram and a Twitter account. You can follow at Contender Game on Twitter, twitter.com/@ContenderGame if you want. But really, I think, well, let me ask you guys. I mean, like, what is the best way for me to stay in touch with you? Is it still a mailing list? I kind of feel it's still a mailing list.
Dude, I hope it is. I mean, it seems like, I don't know. Even as email blew up, I think nowadays you could actually do pretty well with a physical mail list if your products are high enough margin to justify that expense.
Oh, Charlie!
Ah!
Charlie bit Charlie! My finger. Yeah, no, I mean, I guess I just don't know. I mean, like, we're going to do everything, but I am just kind of curious, like, now that we're in the, like, planning phase.
I think absolutely email list. I think you try to use every way you can get a hold of people, but, you know, Charlie
bit my finger.
I was trying to get a play on that.
Charlie's
Black Angels. Charlie Horses Around.
Do we have the show?
The one where we get possessed. The one where Charlie possesses us.
Charlie's not a god.
I just love this phrase the sentence from the Washington Post. The phrase Charlie was trending on Dominican Twitter. Explain that sentence to somebody in 1991.
Nashcom wrote, Charlie bit my Ticonderoga. I'm for that.
All right.
Because it is a Ticonderoga.
Indeed it is.
Do you want to make that the topic about after things, about email, contact, and all that stuff?
Yeah, actually, that's a good idea. Yeah. That's perfect.
Or do you just want to, like, you know, just discuss it before we start after things and go to after things going, I don't know. Brian, when do we get immortality? Or when do robots take our jobs?
Yeah, we probably should have been on the same page going into it.
It's a big debate, too. It is a big, I mean, really effing smart people. Not that we're not smart, but I mean, like, it's forth.
Like smarter people, yeah.
Yeah. All right, yeah, let's start it up and I'll explain the thing to you guys.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the After Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hello.
Brian Brushwood.
Yeah.
So right before the show, Justin started off a discussion that we said, hold it. Let's put this on After Things. Justin, what did you say?
So, you know, and one of the things that I think – you know, we can, I don't think anybody on this podcast will ever say that we are experts on anything, but we can be experts.
We are experts on everything.
Okay. Well, doggone it.
But I do think we are experts in trying things, and we are always a defender of the just go out and do it, as Shia LaBeouf will yell at you in a viral video this week. You know, just seize the moment and take your life.
Is that a reference I missed? Did he?
No, yeah, there was this viral video of Shia LaBeouf giving you a motivational pep talk where he's just being very intense, Shia LaBeouf giving like just seize it. The reason why yesterday you said tomorrow, which means today's the day. Like, you know, just a lot of it's. I'll tell you what, I really don't know what to think of that Shia, but he sure is a fun patch in the quilt work of modern pop culture. Anyhow, so I had an idea with John Teasdale, who you might know on the Night Attack show as the Attack Knight, the Night Attack Knight who might attack Night Attack.
Right.
He works with me at the Go Game, and a while ago did a funny little card game called Who Does Nobody Like, and we had this idea to do another card game, and eventually partnered with some friends of ours, and it's been very, very cool. You know, it's been a really cool process, and we are very happy with where it is. It is a political debate themed game. Probably could be best summed up as if Cards Against Humanity was a political debate. It is not the same mechanics, but similar in kind of some of the, you're going to laugh because somebody is putting down cards that might be contrary to their personality or reflect their personality, and everyone's going to laugh and it's going to be a fun time. Kind of like, Legos for improv, where you can plug together, you know, things and make funny jokes. But we're doing a Kickstarter. It's going to launch in early August, and I have been tasked, because it is probably my only, beyond the ideas of the game and the writing of the cards, probably my only worth to the actual, like, business element of this is like, well, Justin, like, everyone's like, oh, okay, so, well, who's going to handle the taxes? Oh, somebody who actually knows and likes those things. Who's going to handle all the expenses? Oh, somebody who's good with money and numbers and counting. It's like, Justin, what are you going to do? Like,
Twitter. Yeah, I could do Twitter.
Get the word out. I could shout loudly that people should buy it.
Exactly. So it's kind of left me now in trying to in a situation where I got a product that I know people are going to like, that I think will be successful. What from, you know, from here, how do we have the best campaign to roll out for this Kickstarter, and specifically mailing list wise? Like, is a mailing list still the number one thing that we need to work hard to build? Should I be talking to people about trying to make a deal to leverage their mailing lists? Should I be putting my effort into retaining people on social media? You know, is Facebook the place to go, even though I'm not necessarily, I don't have the biggest presence on Facebook, but that's definitely where people talk about politics the most. Is it Twitter, where I'm most comfortable, yet might not be the stickiest, people are going to see it all day kind of situation? So that's really where I'm at, and I would like to throw it out here to the After Things crew to kind of talk about, in general, retention and getting the news out, as the Ad Dragon would say.
Man, I'll tell you what, I don't think I'm right to say this, but my gut says that Facebook is doing so well selling access to people who have indicated that they like your thing, that I think Facebook's whole angle is just focused on big players with big budgets who are doing big ad buys. And I don't think Facebook is a really good place for a small business unless it's a single person and you actually friend them, right? Because the problem with Facebook is if someone has friended me, Brian Brushwood, the person, then, when I post something, it shows up in their timeline. Like right now, I think there are 3,000 friends I have on Facebook. There are 28,000 people who have liked Brian Brushwood, the brand. Brian Brushwood, the brand, posts something, and all of a sudden, you cross fingers and you hope enough people like it that they bother to show it to anyone. So out of the 28,000 people who have liked Brian Brushwood, the brand, oftentimes as few as 700 people will ever see anything I post on there. Because what will happen is it'll be like, I think it's a funny thing or an interesting whatever, and I'll post it on there. And it won't send it out to everyone. It'll send it out to, we'll say, 5%. And then of those, if enough of them indicate, they have to actively like it for them to kind of open it up to more and more and more. And then what they'll do is they'll come back and say, you know, hey, buddy, you know, only 800 people saw your post. You want all 28,000 who've indicated they like you? Why don't you throw us a little scratch? And then they get all fussy about like, well, this is a photo of some text and we don't allow that and whatever.
I am right in the middle of that with trying to give away Fire in the Sky, my Angel Killer mini sequel that goes in between there. And like, do you want to boost this post? And like, oh, yeah, no, 20,000 people follow you. And that was my problem with, and I think the answer is everything, but then you have to decide where do you go first and then second and third. My problem with Facebook was, you know, you and again, they're free to change whatever they want. You know, like Darth Vader on friggin' Cloud City, you know, just
they can alter the deal. That's fine.
Yeah. So you start off with Facebook like, oh yeah, I'll send people here, like my Facebook page, like this is great. It's a great way to reach people. Fantastic. I got thousands of people. Great. I want them to see this. Oh no, we're not gonna show it to them. What? No, you gotta pay us to complete this agreement that you have. Now that I did not know when I started pushing people towards Facebook, that would be the way that it would work.
Dude,
I didn't know
it's even worse than that because I originally did everything as my personal name. I was like, I'll friend you on Facebook. And I hit the max of 5,000 and they said, if you want to go beyond here, there was a brief time. They were like, don't worry, for free, we'll flip your private profile over to a public one. And yep. I was like, oh, and then I could go beyond 5,000. They're like, yeah, you sure can. I was like, okay, let's do that. And so I did that and then ended up deeply, deeply regretting it.
Me too.
Because
me
what's
too.
Funny is here's the perverse thing is the more people who like your page on Facebook, the harder it is to get the word out. Because as a percentage, fewer and fewer people are engaged. You do not want casual interest on your stuff on Facebook. You want a very small, very passionate group that will absolutely like every single thing you do.
It's and so I still do it, and like my publisher really pushes me towards Facebook and all that because you know like every you know there are, you know the problem is like companies and stuff love metrics that they can go and show their bosses.
Yep.
And not necessarily not results. They love metrics, not results, and that's what's frustrating to me. And so I having to please people by yes, I will go do this, I'll go do this thing, although there are better ways to do it. I think primary, it's email. Email's beautiful because email is, I get it. Oh, I like this. I'm going to save this. I'm going to respond to this later on. I get emails, marketing emails all the time for magic stuff that I should delete. They write a good hook. I'm reading it. I'm reading about this trick. I want to see it. Brian Brushwood's telling me I can, you know, put some sort of lockpick around my nuts.
Yep.
Tell me more.
Okay. And I feel like we're sort of tipping the ending of this because I agree with you. I think that the email list is the best place. But before we get to why email is so great, let's maybe dissect some of the other alternatives. Twitter, I think, Justin, you made a really good point in that Twitter is ephemera. It's so easy to get lost in the crowd in there. And unless you want to be that guy who's continuously hammering on the same thing over and over again, that's a hard place to be, although you can do it. If you have a big release coming up, you can release 10 different posts each per day, each one independently interesting, each one also underscoring the fact that this is your big project that you're working on leading up to some big release day. But you have to realize that, you know, that it's ephemera, man. That stuff evaporates into the wind.
Well, I kind of find Twitter's best use to be like with a minute on either side of it, right? Like, you know, if you're reacting to something within a minute and you want someone to do something within a minute, it's best in the business, right? Like you, it's a great way if somebody's like, so let's take this Kickstarter that we're doing. If somebody asks a question about the Kickstarter, wants to know more information about it, wants to know when it's going to be released, what they're going to get, they have another clarifying, question, then I think it's great to turn them into a backer within the next minute after you respond to them.
Right.
Right. It's great if you are about to pass a goal. And so now you can offer to people that are following you, hey, we're in the trench and we're about to fire those, you know, fire into the exhaust port. Can you please help us get over the hump and blow up the Death Star? Because that is very exciting ephemera, right? That's like, I can be a part. I'm here. I'm already at the party where they're going to drop the ball. That's fantastic. I want to be a part of it. But we've all been there. And we could probably, when I say this, we'll immediately think of some names that I know we've all texted each other and rolled our eyes about. Overhype project Twitter guy, you know, like it's hard. I feel bad sometimes.
We're looking at you, Barack Obama. Yeah.
I feel bad because I get too overenthusiastic about my friends' projects. Because I will always retweet my friend's stuff just because I'm at my heart a soccer mom and I just want to see my friend score a goal.
You know, in like anything, like my problem is like I don't – like right now I should be planning my campaign for Name of the Devil and what I'm going to – my publishers have a whole, you know, blog tour thing and all that stuff planned. And I got a couple appearances, but I should be doing more. I'm in the middle of a book I want to finish, and once I finish it, I've been telling myself, okay, then I will plan my campaign because – part of the problem is it all ends up being last minute. Finally, you're ready. Finally, you finish the thing, and now you want to tell people thing. But you really need to think out. Like, there's ways to use Twitter and tell people. You just don't put the same tweet every time. Hey, yes. Check out this. You know, well, here's the cover.
And
this.
Don't even have the same intent every single time. You know, it's like you can't just write 10 versions of the same tweet and expect it to make people feel like it's fresh content. You know, instead, you know, create a campaign. Here's the thing: is Twitter is everybody needs to remember in all of your marketing and business interactions on Twitter, Twitter is a live chat room. It would not make sense right now in the Diamond Club chat to say the same thing every 10 minutes exactly, or to even make the same point. What does make sense is to have a back and forth conversation where it's like, hey guys, I got a crazy idea for a game. I'm taking your suggestions for the next 10 minutes. Whatever you suggest, I'm going to integrate into my next thing. And then people do, and there's back and forth, and there's talking, and it's like, and I've selected a winner. I'll be back in 10 minutes, and we'll play another game. That is what Twitter excels at, does very, very well, right?
Yeah, and it's, you know, it's interesting to see where attention spans are and whatnot. The answer is everything, but I would say, yeah, Justin, the short answer is primary is email, because it's...
No, okay, wait, hold on. There are other vectors, too. And again, I agree, email, but why not a series of YouTube announcements? Or
I said
in what situation?
Primary. I didn't say exclusionary. I said primary. Start from there and then radiate outwards from there. I think yes, certainly. I would say, though, for the amount of effort, if you're super – and also depends who your audience is. Like, I don't have – you know, I'm not a YouTuber. I don't have a big YouTube. I can put up a YouTube video and I might get 500 or 600 views, yeah. You know. And the amount of effort that goes into that versus if I do a really, really well-planned email, I'll get 10,000, you know, people – perspective, you know, it depends on who you're engaging with.
Well, and furthermore, I do believe that you have to understand where your strengths are, not only as a creator, but also as what you connect with people on, and where, if you have an existing audience, where they live, you know, like I can't just walk into YouTube and pretend that I'm a YouTube guy. Now, I could try to go to other YouTube people that I know and try to figure out a way that I can collaborate with them to co-op their audiences. But to just think like, all right, well, this is a big bustling marketplace where a lot of people are, like, it's a lot of long hallways that, and not a whole lot of open foyers on YouTube. You know, like, there's a lot of people that get into their own thing, but it's not exactly a fantastic discovery platform for kind of short-term, this is a project and we need to get moving on it kind of project.
Well, and keep in mind that there are different flavors of experiences available on all different environments. There are people on Facebook who never, ever will follow you on Twitter because they don't understand or like the Twitter environment. There are people on YouTube who will never, ever follow your Facebook. They will never sign up for an email or whatever. However, there's some number of them that will. And the more diversified you could get, like, hey, do you like me enough here on YouTube that you would like to get an email once a week, then why don't you join my clubhouse? This is the reason you see the heavy-handed you know, join my secret newsletter to get the 5 tips in order to lift like a pro. Like, the reason...
Type it away right now, Brian.
As painful as that is, the reason people keep coming back to that is because it works and because it's necessary, because now it's sort of like a RAID array with hard drives, where it's like you can lose an account, or you can lose somebody who loves you on Facebook can fall off of Facebook and, you know, migrate to Twitter. And if you've locked them in on more than one platform, you still have the ability to reach them. If they love both of them, now you could reach them twice, right? Which is part of the reason I still post a bunch of stuff on my Google Plus page. And I, you know, because I want to hit people, especially if it's something about to be released, you want to hit them in multiple ways.
You got like a million Google Plus followers too.
Yeah. Yes. No. Well, I mean,
Though it looks after IO that Google Plus might be pining for the fjords.
Wait, what does that mean? Pining for the fjords? Is that a common phrase?
You know, it's a ex social network. It has ceased to be.
Oh, wait, pining for the fjords? I've never heard that.
It's a Monty Python thing.
Ah, got it.
Right. It's only one of the most like famous sketch comedy.
Mm. I'm not a comedian. I don't do comedy.
Justin, can't you just enjoy the moment? You're smarter than us. Can't you just do that instead of rubbing it in? I'm like
us. So that's both of us, right?
We is this a Thor reference? years ago I wrote a book called How to Make an Action Movie for $99, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it was based on my experience of knowing nothing about film and saying, hey, why should that stop me? And saying, like, I'm not going to go broke doing this. So, and that was fun. And I thought about revisiting that, but now with a, you know, like how to build your own empire, talking a lot about the lessons I've learned watching Brian, watching Justin, watching Tom Merritt and other people and all that, and condensing that sort of thing. And I thought, like, what's the first thing I would tell people to do when you want to build your empire? And that is start building your list. Start to build your list. This is every empire does a survey, does a census. They say, what is the size of this? What is our domain? Right now, everybody listening to it who has some interest in sharing something with somebody at some point that you need an audience for, start a list. You know what? It does not need to be 5,000. It doesn't need to be 50,000. If you have 5 people, 5 really good friends who will take a bullet for you and will get the word out there, that's great. That's a fantastic start, and that's where you need to start, is to say, this is where I begin. Because the problem is we confuse, you know, you can confuse having hundreds of thousands of Twitter followers for having an army of a couple hundred thousand people. That's just everybody that's ever said, oh, okay. That's not everybody who's in love with you. That's right. Not everybody who is, you know, like, hey, guys, let's meet at midnight with pitchforks. I've got an idea. And that's probably most people listening right now. We would all be into that.
And again, realize, and this is not to you, Justin, because I know you already get this, but for anyone who has a project that they're trying to build up steam to, understand that when you see Louis C.K. announce that his new special is $5 and makes $1 million in 18 hours or whatever, understand it is not the fact that he did not make that money in that 18 hours. He made it in the 20 years of brand value and friendship and trust and diehard passionate fanship that he built up into it. And finally, he opened up a floodgates and said, oh, by the way, did you guys feel like maybe you owed me $5 over all these years? Please, here's where to send it. So as a result, you know, you need to be very careful about how often you push buttons. You know, it's you can't keep hitting the same button without... I don't know. It's you got to fuel on the tank.
And Louis C.K. is always such an interesting example when it comes to this kind of stuff, because he, like a lot of game-changing examples, he is typical and not typical all at once, right? And ultimately, as we've seen things play out, the greatest benefit that Louis C.K.'s selling directly to his audience had on stand-up comic specials, right, even just that market, was that it expanded the ability for people to sell their specials to other people, because that special let Netflix know, oh, what, like, people are into non-traditional ways. You don't got to just be on HBO or Showtime anymore. People just like stand-up comedy and they want to get it in other ways. And so it expanded Epics and Netflix and all these other places, and it wasn't necessarily just every comic had to be a direct mail master.
And what it didn't do is his own platform really wasn't able to do much for anybody else. It worked great because of all that equity, as Brian pointed out. But it's that, you know, the right person and the right product is what really works well. And Louis C.K. was like $5 or this or that. And it's interesting when you see experiments that don't get repeated to, you know, you have Radiohead does an album one way, like, oh, name your price, whatever. And then they didn't do it again because it was that worked right at that point, because there's a lot of conversation about where these things should be, and then these things don't. And
But then there's the counterexample of Pebble, where it's like they were the most, you know, one of the biggest Kickstarter success stories in history. So you would think that they would be able to say, hey, version two is out at this set price, but instead they played the Kickstarter game again, and you know, and depending on what gossip you hear, you know, it's either working out or not working out for them. But I know that certainly a lot of people, including yours truly, threw the money through the same exact mechanism.
Yeah, I hope it works out for them. The stories behind the scenes are scary.
Yeah, a little bit sketch.
Yeah, but you know, again, but yeah, exactly. But that was, they went back to their audience. They said, hey, the people who, and it was funny because they were made possible. You know, there were people who had a great product before. They had done a lot of work, and they were not sketchy people doing a really legitimate thing the first time around. And that audience was there. That's, they knew, let's go back to here because that worked out really well there. And, you know, again, start now with just a list of people that you can contact to,
dude,
and say,
right,
that you have permission to.
I just went to the Pebble page, courtesy of Neshcom's use of the second screen feature at diamondclub.tv/second screen, and they are not looking for your Twitter. They are not looking for your Facebook. They are looking for your email.
Yep.
So let me ask you about email then. If email is king, and I can build, and so now starting today, I can start my email and, you know, for this project specifically, and say, all right, everybody who's interested in this, we set up a splash page with an email widget, and say, MailChimp widget, and say, all right, everybody, come on in. Everybody, get in here. Past that, I've got everything that I can get by the time that early August comes around. Is it worth it to go to other people for which I know have similar audiences or are in the demo for which would be interested in this, and ask them to either purchase access to or have them send out a thing on their email?
Well, okay. So you made a very good clarification where it's like purchase access to is those are all dirty four-letter words, right? That sounds an awful lot like sell their list to. And if you were to write, you know, let's say iJustine, you know, iJustine says, Justin, I think you're really great. Here's my entire email list. You can write them all an email. Regardless of how big it is, I think it would mean nothing to any of them. You would get virtually no benefit from it. However, if iJustine, you know, did her, I just, you know, in the next level is iJustine says, hey guys, I know you're fans of me. Here's something I really like by Justin Robert Young. Still not that great.
Yeah.
But if they could come up with a campaign, and this is why nowadays what you buy is you buy influence. You buy people actively participating who actually believe in their stuff. If iJustine says, holy crap, guys, here's the hot new game coming out, and I've been told that I have the chance to name one political figure from history to be a card in this game. Let's play our contest. Who should it be? I think it should be Abraham Lincoln, but maybe it'd be funnier if it was Ron Paul. Or what if it was a werewolf hybrid of Ron Paul and, you know, whatever, Timothy Geithner or whatever. And relevant.
Ring the bell for the Timothy Geithner reference that we all look forward to every week.
Now all of a sudden you have something, you know, especially if it's like, you know, like, and plus also, you know, whoever sends me the best ideas, you're going to get a free set of them and I'm going to sign them, along with all the creators or whatever. That is something that, number one, because keep in mind, for as much as you're thinking, how do I get the word out? Justine is also thinking, how do I provide valuable content for, you know, my flock, right? How do I keep them excited and feeling like they're up to date into what I'm up to?
I absolutely agree. I think that's the mistake that often has been made is like, oh, I'll put this out on my list. Like, yeah, like it, Brian nailed it where, yeah, I, you know, if Brian puts out a link for, hey, my buddy Andrew Main did Name of the Devil, and the ones who don't know who I am, like, how do I, what's the scam? How do I use this to get chicks? What happens here? Well, you just read it and the chicks will be interested in it. you know, and that's, it's context, everything. You have to sort of create a desire, create it. Now, what I would say, Justin, is that like, you have a lot of people who don't have a huge following, but have an interest in you and like you, and you can certainly think about ways of, you have both. But I'm saying is you have, there's an audience there that if you say, hey, you know, I have a, you know, I have a special, you know, the gold pack or whatever for anybody who shares this, uses this link to buy it and shares this link, you get the gold card or the gold pack or do something like that. Which you create something special for those people. That's first and foremost, is you're creating a special experience for people who want something special, and then you're encouraging them to share.
Oh no, definitely. And I think like, and that kind of gets more into the into the social element of it, and the direct communication between you know, like me and anybody who would be kind of qualified that's already sort of in my net, right? What I'm kind of curious about now, if you know, we understand as email is king, you know, like, is, you know, what then what is that game plan? What is that, you know, like, pick your favorite card, or, you know, like, or like, am I identifying other people that are kind of in this thing that would like that, I genuinely think that would like this, that I either have a soft relationship to or no relationship to or a good relationship with? Like, what is the mutually beneficial, non-offensive, non-skeezy, like, you know, non-used car salesman, you know, way to go about that?
What value can you create for them? And I think like a value that would be cool is there a way for you to do a hastily sketched, whatever personalized card from you that goes into the pack? You create, make them into a villain or make them into a character or something.
Can I let me do this. I mean, number one, that's absolutely correct. But speaking to Justin's strengths, a week or two ago, I recommended John Acuff's Do Over, and I do not. I think there's maybe two blogs I will check regularly. I'll check Reasons Hit and Run, and I'll check Cracked. Regularly. That's the only kind of blogging platform that I really look at. Everything else is like if Reddit directs me over there or whatever. John Acuff, his new book, Do Over, is about, you know, reinventing yourself every few years, you know, not necessarily getting fired or leaving or whatever. I will never check it out. I don't do RSS feeders, and it seems like a lot of other people don't do as well. But I did at some point sign up for his for his email thing. And basically, the guy writes a blog post every, I don't know, maybe it is every day, but I don't always read them, but it's something that is of value in and of itself. Maybe it's just a quote he sends out. So because this guy has a reputation, you know, more days than not, he's sending out content, not a request to action, not a call to action, not a you know, a thing he needs you to do. It's just content. Take it or leave it, right? And then one of those days, something will look like content, and I'll get in there. Or maybe it'll look like there's an emergency happening, right? And that's the day that you all of a sudden, like a lightning bolt, trigger all that goodwill, all of that that background suddenly becomes something different.
And it's also a great way to get people, like if he's putting useful, helpful things there, is that you get that and you go, oh, I want to forward that to a friend. I want to share that. And exactly. That's how he builds his list.
Yeah. Well, for example, right now, you know, it's like the wait is over, it's available. And this is one of those harvesting days. He did all this planting with telling stories, and his story is, here are the things I'm discovering or whatever. And your story, likewise, Justin, might be, you know, things I realized trying to create a game, you know, and you say blah, blah, blah. And, you know, you provide value, 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 which is nothing but planting seeds, planting seeds, planting seeds. And there will come a day like this when it'll be a harvesting day. And then you'll be able to say, today is the day. Here's what you can do. You know, buy from these places and be specific and direct in your direction.
Oh, good. He's at Parable.
What's that?
He's at Parable. Good.
What is
Parable? I got a rewards card there.
Oh, do you?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay. I was confused.
I don't know what that means.
I think it's a Christian bookstore.
I mean, like if I were making a joke about a Christian bookstore, I'd probably call it Parable.
Yeah, got it.
No, that's a really, really good idea. And it's certainly, that is, I think, part of the missing piece, I think, for a lot of people is that oftentimes whenever we kind of get into, and this is kind of a common theme with After Things even, is everybody wants the magic pill. You know, the magic, the one crazy trick that'll change everything. And ultimately, if we have learned anything in the modern world of doing business and leveraging your personality to do business is just continuing to put your personality out there, you know, and whether or not your personality is exactly honing it to be what your audience wants is an art in and of itself. But you can't win the game unless you show up, and you can't show up unless you are putting just even if it's a little something for people to connect to. So not only do they know more about you and therefore you can help inform their decision when you have something to come out, but also so they can read into, you know, more and more about, you know, where they connect with you, which is almost just as important.
Heartily agree. I think I've been having fun with the weird things list that we put out for our Patreon for weird things. And you know, for me, I don't find, you know, if I'm trying to finish a book, I feel guilty if I'm writing anything other than the book. But when I find some interesting little article, you know, sometimes it's two or three a day and it's quick. It's just one sentence sort of things like, hey, here's something cool. Here's a little thought on it, whatever. And I'll probably do something like that for my own purposes at some point, you know, maybe more in the writing creative sort of space, because I said, all right, I can just say, hey, here's something cool to look at, whatever, and I have some neat exchanges with the people who've been reading those. Not everything has to be a 1,000-word essay, you know. Not everything, it can just be, here's something interesting, and it just to develop it. You are what you do. What I want to talk about is there's a documentary on HBO called Banksy Does New York, and the documentary is well worth watching. It's also on, I think, iTunes too. I felt like the documentarians probably, you know, the problem is their subject is so much more making such a bigger statement and such a more powerful thing than the ability to sort of cover it. And how do you cover this thing when you decide to do it after the fact? And it was sort of a weird way that it was sort of put together, but the subject is absolutely fascinating. And what it was is last year, Banksy took up a residency, a self-proclaimed residency in New York, and every day for 30 days, he would create some new piece of art, some new art installation, sometimes legally, sometimes not, around the city. And it might be, as there's an image we just saw, which was a pile of rubble that looked kind of like a sphinx or a skull. It might be a little tiny illustration on a wall somewhere or whatever. And it was a really, really awesome thing. Like, where will he show up next? What will happen next? Some things were small, some things were big, where he had the back of a truck was filled with what looked like the serene waterfall type scene. He had another truck that had all these stuffed animals poking through the wooden slats of the boards that were like moving and crying and all that as you drove around like the meatpacking district. and he did a very, very, you know, thought-provoking one, which was this scene of this, it was in an alley, looked like an alley, and it was these militarized looking war horses trampling, and then there was a soundtrack playing when there was in the Iraq, I think it was Iraq, where the incident where they shot several people who were non-combatants, whatever, and you listen to the soundtrack of the soldiers they play over, and it's a thing that makes you stop and think about, you know, when we're militarily engaged and stuff. And he may have, you know, he has a point of view on stuff but it's very well presented. So, but what was curious to me was like at one point they did a thing at Central Park
and they had a guy there who had, this was the installation, was he actually had an old man that had about 20 or 30 original Banksy drawings or paintings or stencils. And they were selling them for $60 a piece. They sold like 6 or 7 of them. They only sold, you know, that's how many they sold. So the total net they made for that day was like $420. Each one of those was worth $250,000.
That's crazy.
I'm a guy, I've walked back and forth in Santa Monica, and I've seen people selling. I've seen a guy with a booth selling Banksy's before. And I'm like, and my reaction is like, well, I think he's just stealing Banksy's stuff, and I don't want to support that. Even though I'd like to have a Banksy on my wall, I won't support that. And I wondered how many people walking by there were going, maybe those aren't legal Banksy's or whatever. But for Banksy, Banksy wasn't trying to make a statement about copyright. Banksy wasn't trying to make a statement about anything. I mean, he was trying to make his own sort of statement, but it was a Banksy-esque statement. But you think about the fact that, you know, there were, you know, several millions of dollars worth of Banksy's were given away that day.
Yeah.
And that is his value. That was what mattered to him. It wasn't he's a guy who's comfortable. He's a guy that is successful. He's a guy that has money. What he really wants to be able to do is maintain his – to pull these things off, he's got a core group of people that protect his secret. We know who he is, but we'll pretend that we don't. That protect the secret of who he is, who protect the secrecy of this moment because they're loyal to him because he's very true to what he is. And if Banksy started doing, you know, if Banksy were a different kind of artist and he started doing Coca-Cola labels or Reeboks or something like that,
yeah,
he would lose that currency. For him, that currency is what matters. And that's a very important thing to think about, is that he's not trying to become a billion-dollar artist. He's not trying to do this. He's trying to create work that really gets people to think and continues to get that kind of authenticity that it has. Regardless of that, the New York art blogs didn't, our New York art scene didn't want to cover him. You know, they think it's lowbrow or whatever. They were too above it. And it didn't get the kind of blow up that it should have because whatever. But it's still a thing to think about. What is your goal? You know, one, you know, at some point, yes, paying your bills should be a goal. But then you want to have a larger goal beyond that. And, you know, we know of an artist in our industry whose goal is to reach a billion-dollar level and who's approaching that, but lives a life that none of us would want to live, you know, and his life, once he passes that goal, won't be that different than when he passed 100 million and really even 10 million.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Love three commas.
King of the commas. Put that on his gravestone.
Well, oh, and you look at that too. Like right now, what's happened to Jay-Z, you know, with Tidal.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Jay-Z.
I don't know what happened.
Well, Jay-Z with Tidal is, you know, trying to create, you know, Jay-Z, he wants, you know, he wants to become a billion-dollar rap artist or billion-dollar producer, billion-dollar from doing that, which would be fine. And what part of the goal of Tidal is he's trying to set this music subscription service up to be that kind of thing. But it just rubbed a lot of people the wrong way when you watch a bunch of multimillionaires on stage talking about, you know, acting like, you know, they're fighting for the rights to, you know, like they're independent starving artists and stuff. And I'm sure they have grievances with their record companies and stuff. And many of them are genuine and stuff. But when you're watching people who fly around in Learjets and private jets and stuff talking about this is taking back music, it's like, I can't quite relate. And he's been getting heat from that because, you know, he wants to flip this into a bigger company that then, you know.
Well, because that's about the music, especially in hip hop that, you know, once Dre became the first billion-dollar rap star with the Beats acquisition. That now, I mean, and listen, it makes sense. Jay-Z's a good person to get into that, and I do think that there is an argument to be made about, you know, what is a more sustainable model for artists with streaming stuff. But yeah, holy moly! I mean, the only thing you ever want to hear about when you have that amount of artists up on stage talking about your product is here's where you can get the exclusive stuff that I'm only going to give to the people that are on this service, because that's the relationship we have with them, is we like their work and we want their work. And here is a better, quicker, faster, more original, exclusive way that I can get their work. Not so much, you know, Kanye West, sympathetic, though he is, doe-eyed Kanye West saying, you know, finally, I'm going to get a fair shake and make some money. You know, it's not maybe the best optics.
I think it was Noel Gallagher had the best comment, though. He says, what do they think they are, the effing Avengers? But again, it's been, I think that, you know, we need disruption, and I want him to succeed, you know, but it comes across as like, on one hand, you have an artist like Banksy who's like, is doing such a thing that he's willing to throw away so much value just because that's what the value is for him.
Well, because he realized that in throwing away, like, let's say he sets fire to a $2 million, you know, opportunity, he knows that what he's really doing is buying $2 million of credit among his hardcore fans for having done it.
And it's hard and it's weird because, like, you know, we use terms and money to quantify those things, but as you know, you've talked about before, you know, when you reach a certain income level, like the $70,000 sort of level, money becomes less of an incentive. And when you're a successful artist that says, all right, I put away enough, I know that I'm never gonna have to worry about, you know, feeding my kids or college or whatever, and I'll be able to eat where I want, do what I want, then yeah, it's about, you know, there are
diminishing returns from that point forward.
Yeah, we know,
well,
people
and this is like, it's, I guess, I think probably the overarching thing that we're trying to get to is it isn't always about money once you get to sustainability, right? There are goals beyond that I think the default is always, well, just make as much money as you can, which of course, hey, listen, man, if that's you, then do you. You know, if that's where you are, then that's what you need to do. But, you know, there are other ways to do it. And there are other ways that you can live very comfortably and you know, still provide for every other element that you would in generally want to provide for while still fulfilling something that might be more suited for your personality.
And I know people like using magic. I know people who've gone into like marketing magic products and stuff who have, let's say, violated probably what are copyrights, but have more money to get away with it than other people do, mm-hmm. Than the people they're violating or whatever, who don't go to magic, don't go to certain places because they are going to be unwelcomed, because they're going to be unwelcome. And I know of comedians who are, you know, you watch them on HBO or whatever, they're successful in that ground. They don't get to hang out with everybody else, not because they're successful, because of the way they got there. And there's a price that was paid because it was like, yeah, you know, you took this from this person, you used this joke, so you were completely a jerk to these other people. Nobody likes you. The people you wanted to get the respect from don't want to talk to you.
Yep.
And that is.
Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy.
I mean, unless that's what you want to be, in which case, who are we to tell you?
Be more of that guy. Yeah,
be the best version
of that guy that can be bought.
Absolutely, man. That was a good one. I think it's been after.
I think you're right. I think you said it. It has been after.
I think it's actually been after.
Da 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 da. What?
Hi, I'm Ben After.
Well, have you heard the honest trailers? They did one on Armageddon.
No.
They cut in there. They have a voiceover from Ben Affleck. When he's doing the commentary, and he goes, you know, I asked Michael Bay. I said, wouldn't it be more practical to have to teach astronauts how to drill? And he says, and Michael Bay told me to shut the blank up.
What was the title that we went with for the main episode?
It was Bryce's suggestion.
Pencil brand.
Oh, Ticonderoga. Here, I'll just write Charlie. And then I'm going to get ready to upload. Good job, team.
Yay, team.
Yeah, FYI, guys, I don't think I'm going to stream the wrestling tonight because it is a thing in the middle of the regular pay-per-view schedule, and I need to do my taxes. But I will be doing Jury. Jury will be after the wrestling wraps up.
Glad you're getting your taxes done on May
31st. Oh, dude.
I paid them. I just need to file them.
Yeah, dude. And by the way, people don't realize everybody gets an automatic extension. Like, you don't have to have a reason, an excuse, or anything. Well, all you have to do is say, I'll get you later by April 15th.
One thing. Yes, and that extension goes to October 15th. And so that's why I'm going, why? You got April, October. But also, you do pay a penalty for that.
I don't think that's true.
Late. Finally, there's a depends when you pay.
Well, oh yeah, no. Yeah. Always pay a beforehand. Like, yeah, just throw all the money you have at the IRS And then, like, as long as the IRS owes you money, you could take as long as you want to get around to filing.
So, funny thing though is, I just got a notice of a. I had the IRS ask me twice for a tax return from a previous year, and I sent it, and they sent it again. I finally sent it again, and they said, "Okay, we got it." And then I got a thing like, "Oh, well, you owe us for late filing and all this other sort of stuff." I'm like, "Really?" I go look, and like I'm on the phone with like I pull up a thing that showed with that when I had the Intuit, you know, that I transmitted it and it was successfully transmitted, and I took that with me and I had to go run somewhere, and I'm on the phone, you know, waiting in a parking lot talking to the IRS guy. He's like, "No, well, that doesn't count because it means it got accepted and all this, and so do you want to pay?" And I'm like, "I'm pretty sure this thing got accepted, you know." But like, "Well, do you want to?" I'm like, "Let's send me the letter." I go home. Sure enough, IRS has received your taxes and all this, and so I have it's now I got to go through the whole like, "Guys, you said it got accepted, and you know you lost it three times now. Congratulations."
Yeah.
Which is a pain.
Yeah, man. The IRS. What are we gonna do with these guys?
All right, I'm gonna shut down the butt. So long, butt.
Keep it button.
Then I'm gonna.
Yeah, sorry, Escobar. I ain't got it in me, man, to do all these things.
Sorry, guys. No, you like me, but I'm gonna disappoint you.
Yeah, you know, I'll live tweet it. Whatever I can watch.
Yeah. What?
You know, they're actually this wrestling thing's actually like kind of brilliant. They did a free month for the WWE Network in May, right? Which means that you need to unsubscribe before midnight, or it rolls over
tonight
into a paid subscription.
And so they do a major event that's going to be free for everyone tonight.
So they have a exclusive on the network event that ends 2 hours. So you have 2 hours by the end of the event.
That's amazing.
To unsubscribe from the WWE Network. Which I hope that they just do. It's just another, just 2 hours of like Hulk Hogan doing the robot dance on the network. And then it's just like double middle fingers as they count all their money.
Signing up right now.
Okie dokie. Yeah, let's wrap things up. All right, so long, guys. Thank you so much for joining us.
Adios.
You enjoyed how weird the things were.